Hello, Nana here. Welcome to Diablo 3. The Necromancer pack has landed. And of course, I have to play through the game with a Necromancer. In Diablo 2, the Necromancer was my favorite class. I built many, many Necromancers. So now that Diablo 3 finally has a Necromancer, of course, I have to play through the entirety of the story with a Necromancer. So it's been a while since I did the story, so it is a nice opportunity to do so. Anyway, I'm getting slightly tired of doing adventure mode over and over again whenever I play in a new season. Right now, there's no season, so we'll just be playing this on the normal hardcore mode, not the seasonal hardcore mode. So we got some Paragon points. I'm not going to use Paragon points. I want to see what the vanilla leveling experience would be. As such, I'm gonna try to not use any of the items from the stash either. We should have gotten some extra stash tabs. So if we want to store items, we'll just do that in the new stash tabs that we got for the Necromancer pack. And basically play this as vanilla as possible. That's it. We're gonna play on hardcore. So if we die, we truly die. This is the actual hardcore. There are no second chances. There's no demoting characters to non-hardcore. If you're dead, you're dead. And also, we'll be playing on Torment 1 difficulty, just because the regular difficulties feel a little on the easy side. And Torment 1, I played with another Necromancer until about level 13. And Torment 1 felt actually slightly challenging, and the difficulty before that, I believe that Master didn't. So yeah, we'll see if this was a grave mistake or whether this is going to be awesome. But with that, let's begin. This is going to be a full story playthrough, so I will be watching all of the videos. I'll be letting all of the dialogue play out, and in between we'll just move forward. So let's get started.
That grows must also wither and die. What dies and rots will then nourish the living. This is the great cycle of being, and we, the priests of Rathma, use our dark art to protect it. Though most do not understand us, we go where we are needed. My master has learned that a star fell in the west, drawing the dead from their graves. He commands me to journey to Tristram and return them to their rest. For if the cycle is not upheld, it would mean the end of all things.
Tum-tum-tum. Okay, we start back outside.
I am near the fallen star, and the dead it raised.
So we start with a standard attack, which summons some spikes from the ground. It's called Bone Spikes. It generates essence, which is the resource that the Necromancers have. And our abilities use it. There's no passive regeneration of essence by default. Maybe later on of your items, but by default there's no regeneration, like for example the Witch Doctor's mana. But it's the default attack that we start with. At least it's AoE. We are getting a pretty massive experience bonus from playing on Torment. I think we get 3 times the normal XP. So let's have a look. We got a Bone Spear, which summons a piercing projectile that causes 500% weapon damage as physical to all enemies it passes through. So that's going to consume essence, and this is going to generate essence. And that is a Bone Spear.
I have come to aid these lands. Where is the fallen star?
It fell on the old cathedral. There was only one survivor, Leah. You should speak with her. Captain Rumford, more dead are coming. We can't open the gates until we drive them back.
First, we start out with a pitiful weapon. We are an apprentice necromancer after all. So our first job is going to be to actually get some decent gear. And our life is also very much on the low end. Let's intentionally get hit by a zombie. Let's see if we actually can get hit. Just to get a feel for how much damage we're taking. Not overly impressive, to be honest. Like that. Then again, there's zombies.
Guards, open the gates.
The slow kind of zombies.
Zakharum has fallen to disgrace.
Let's see, that's an issue. We kind of have infinite money.
Got a right good bunch of things for you this fine day.
But okay, so we're gonna allow ourselves the use of money to at least craft gear, so it's gonna be maybe slightly stronger than you would normally have for a normal playthrough. But that's gonna be it, so we can get ourselves a little bit of better gear. And yeah, so get a little bit. So the paragon thing we can just close to at least make the thing disappear.
For many years, villagers were too afraid to settle near the ruins of the cursed town Tristram. But as time went by, adventurers arrived to loot the old cathedral, and their business was profitable enough that new Tristram sprang up to accommodate them. Fewer travelers visit now, though, and the town is mostly populated by craftsmen and farmers.
Are you Leah? Did you survive the Fallen Star?
I did, but it blasted my uncle, Deckard Cain, into the depths of the old cathedral. I tried to search for him, but the dead were already rising. I came back here to rally the militia, but...
Watch out! The wounded are turning!
Oh, no. Zombies in sight.
This is killing business.
So the necromancer has one other interesting thing, that everything you kill gets turned into a corpse, which comes to lie on the floor, and later on we will unlock abilities that we can use to consume those corpses and do fun things with them.
The dead will overwhelm us all unless something is done.
Yes, that is why I am here.
Thank you. You should speak with Captain Rumford at the gate. He can tell you what to do.
Okay, let's just grab Leah's book over
here.
He's
been under siege for 6 days now. Uncle Deckard is still missing. Captain Rumford and the others are losing hope. I tell them not to lose faith. But if help doesn't arrive soon...
Rumford came.
There was another book over here.
We have come at last to Tristram's old cathedral. This is where Diablo, Lord of Terror, first corrupted mankind. This is where I may finally find the answers I seek. Leah worries after my safety, but I believe information vital to defeating the last lords of the burning hells can be found here.
I will bring peace to the risen dead.
I admire your courage, but Captain Dalton and the militia were slaughtered by those things. Only I survived.
I have experience in these matters.
Well, I have seen you fight. Strike at the wretched mothers and their queen. They're the ones vomiting out these horrors.
They're attacking the barricades!
Beginning is a little heavy on dialogue, but...
There are more of them in the ruins down the road.
Of course, this is setting the scene. We got a Grim Scythe as a new ability. Slash with a summoned scythe in front of you, dealing 150% of weapon damage is physical. So that's gonna be pretty cool. So this is gonna be our generator, and then we have a spender on our right mouse button. So I played through it until level 13, so I tested out most of the earlier abilities. Grim Scythe, you have to be in melee range to make it work, which, well, for hardcore might not be the most ideal place you wanna be. On the other hand, you are hitting quite some foes at the same time. Damage is presumably slightly better than the bone spikes. Actually, you get more essence per enemy hit. If you hit two enemies, then you get more essence than with the bone spikes. So that's the advantage. You probably don't have to use it all that often. And this early on with the zombies, it's all pretty okay. But my playstyle generally veers more towards just having an army of minions and getting close, and myself staying a little bit further behind and just having more artillery functions or debuffing or whatever works for the build. So Grimscythe, I'm dropping it. We're gonna go back to the bone spikes and then we're pushing forward.
I understand so much more now.
Yay, and now we get corpse explosion. Target an area, exploding up to 5 corpses within 11 yards, dealing 350% weapon damage as physical to enemies within 20 yards. So that allows us to explode corpses, and it is fun. Especially because once you get some corpses going, you generate more corpses, which you can explode, and it at some point it does become a bit of a cascade. Okay, vortex foe. Okay, first loose. Okay. So a slight difference between taking a character that has already leveled a bit and then moving up to a higher difficulty versus just starting out with a new character is if your gear is a bit on the weak end, it takes a little bit longer to take out the blues.
20 years, the burden of countless failures and tragedies heaped upon my shoulders. Am I being punished for helping that stranger hunt the Dark Wanderer? I always thought Deckard Cain half a madman, but perhaps he was right. Perhaps he can banish the shadow hanging over my life.
So Warif was the merchant, I believe, from Diablo 2.
I need essence.
As I brought you at least from Act 1 to Act 2. I think for the other acts you had other people ferry you about. Leaving a bit of a trail of corpses here. Just leave that you get closer. We can explode corpses and generate a new corpse. So in this case the lower monster density kind of works against us. But once we get corpses, we can start cascading it. This is starting to get fun, but the startup is a little bit slower. But of course, Diablo 3 it has a rather slow start. You really get your abilities drip fed to you, and there's not a lot of things that you can do. But well, as you level, you gain new abilities, and especially because we are playing on Torment, we gain a lot of XP, so we will be gaining levels faster than we normally would. If you haven't played Diablo in a while, then it might come as a surprise that the areas no longer have fixed levels in the game. They actually level along with you. So it doesn't really matter what level you are, because the area will always match to suit it. Ah, okay, new ability, Skeletal Mage. This is a nice one. We raise a skeleton from the ground to attack your foes, dealing 400% weapon damage as physical over 2 attacks. Lasts 6 seconds. So they deal quite some damage, and they keep attacking quite rapidly. And of course, all it costs us is essence, which we generate by just using our main attack. So there's decent amount of synergy, and we can really go ham with them. The duration is a bit on the short end, but you can amass a small mini army of mages nonetheless. And it is nice to just get a little bit of extra damage going to help you take down foes before you get some corpses to feed into corpse explosion. And the nice thing is they travel with you rather than staying where you cast them. So they're a little bit like the guardian, the hydra that the wizard can summon, but with a shorter duration, and they move. But conceptually, they have a similar feel to them. Just plop them down and shoot stuff. We gained yet another level, so let's have a look. We gain our first rune for Bone Spikes. Bone Spikes stun enemies for 1 second, which is pretty awesome. How are we with loot? We're not really getting a lot of loot. That's to be expected. It is still early on, right? But stunning enemies kind of helps keep them in place, prevent them from attacking me, so it's a safety feature. We got ourselves a buckler that is better than what we have. Don't really care that much about cooldowns because we don't actually have any yet. Or don't have any on the skills yet. One of the nice things is of these skeletal mages is they're somewhere hybrid between a spell and a minion. I think that is actually a nice thing for Necromancer, because as a Necromancer you want to have an army of minions, because that's what Necromancers do. You Necromancer. And for that, you need an army. Okay, let's see, we got some natural corpses. Yeah, that got... Oh. As you can see, getting hit by things, it hurts a little. Quite a little, actually. So one of the interesting things about Corpse Explosion, at least to me that's interesting, is that it doesn't use or consume essence. All it does is consume corpses. So corpses really are a resource that you use, that you generate and consume as a necromancer. And it's not just all about the essence. Which I think is a nice choice. Oi! You are... Yes. Was something still alive or undead or something along those lines there. Okay, so let's make a trip back to town.
Thank you for your help, but could you talk some sense into Leah? She won't give up on the idea of rescuing her uncle.
Interesting. If he lives, his knowledge could prove useful. I have trained well.
Yay, we got new pants. So we get some vitality. Ooh, that is gonna help us stay alive more. So we currently have 274 life. And it gives us another 80 life. That is pretty darn sweet. So two-handed weapon would boost our damage a bit, but losing the block from a shield, I think at this point might not be the best of ideas.
I will help you find your uncle, Leah.
We'll need to open the cathedral first. The guards locked it up before they were ambushed. Rumford told me they fought their way back to Adria's hut. The key must still be there.
I promised Marco I'd protect him, but now he's dead.
Let's just salvage some of the stuff we found. Oh right, this is the starter gear I bought from the merchant. So can we actually craft some items here. So as a necromancer, there's two kinds of weapons that are specific to us. On the one hand, we can go with a one-handed scythe combined with a phylactery in our offhand. Or we can go with a big two-handed scythe and really walk about as the Grim Reaper. I think for now, that did mention that blocking was nice. On the other hand, if we keep everything at bay, then having more damage is going to be better. And of course, we do get bonus points for style. And we get 13 life per hit with this scythe. That is pretty nice, because that is also going to help us stay alive. So there are trade-offs. In terms of armor, let's see, craft a little bit. Okay, we do have something there. We only have light armor there. The fact that we're leveling up quickly means that we will be out-leveling our old gear faster as well. As such, it is a little bit more important to just stay up to date. But the gear we had, it was kind of absolute trash, and now it's only going to be slightly less absolute trash. And that was also unsalvageable, so we'll sell that to the merchant, and then we'll push forward. You might be interested in. And it is written, a fire. So go back to the waypoint where we came from, and then Leah's going to open the gate for us.
Adria was my mother, but I don't know much about her. She died when I was very young. I was raised by Uncle Deckard.
Did you know your father?
I'm told he was a great warrior who was lost when Tristram fell to the demons.
Aha! I like this corpse explosion. Oh, we actually got ourselves a mini scythe, which is nearly as good as what we have, and it is a one-hander. Things like that will keep happening until we get to a point where the gear is a bit cellar. Better and upgrades are smaller.
Dark magic lingers here.
People said she was a witch, but I never believed it.
Okay, let's just keep our distance here. This boss has a freeze attack, which is less pleasant to be standing in, because you get frozen and it takes some damage and really not good for your health. Also, I did forget to take advantage of the corpses that were lying there, because we could have used that in order to just deal more damage to the boss while it was still standing there next to them.
Here's the key, and my mother's journal. What I've seen of it is disturbing. I want to know more about her, but that can wait. We need to save Uncle Deckard first.
Leave that to me. You'd best stay and learn what you can.
Thank you.
Aiden came to me last night. I suspected what was lurking within his troubled heart. I consoled him as best I could. Regardless, wherever he's headed, hell will surely follow in his wake. The shadows close in on Tristram once again. But like Aiden, I'll be gone before they fall.
So we got some upgrades. We now have a new right mouse rune. Damage is increased by 15% for each enemy that the Bone Spear passes through. So, still the Bone Spear. Animation actually looks a little bit like the old one. Sounds different, but with the training circles behind it, it looks like the old one. The Diablo 2 Bone Spear. The Corpse Lance. Target an enemy to summon projectiles from nearby corpses that cause 1750% weapon damage as physical to the target. So can't currently demo this because we don't actually have a legal target. So I'll be trying out all the new skills and runes briefly, just to get a feel for them. But things that obviously don't work with the build will just switch. Let's see.
I must have a corpse.
So one of the nice things about the corpse lance is that we used the corpse that was over here to damage a foe that was over there. So one of the problems that we kept running into before where we were doing damage. Well, we were killing things, leaving corpses, but the enemies we wanted to damage with the corpses never were really close to them.
That is not possible.
Now we actually have a means to damage them. Also, those bone spear target markers are, or corpse lance target markers, they are insanely obvious. So bone marrow is, or the bone spear is quite a bit cheaper to use than the skeleton mages. By default we start out with 200 essence, so we can cast it 10 times before we're out. That said, I do like the mages more. They're 40 essence, so we can only cast them 5 times. And corpse lance, it's interesting. We'll keep that one for a while. Remember this being an ambush down here. Of course, they don't realize that actually they're the ones getting ambushed. Okay. A small ambush, but still. It was an ambush.
That is not possible.
Let's see, is there a stump? There's, but nothing in it. Something off to the side. Nope. Okay, now we push forward. How far can the corpse lance go? Because we got corpses there, and we got future corpses over there. Because there's the risen dead. Oh wow!
I must have a corpse.
That is not possible.
That's quite a travel distance. I approve. So the utility of corpse lance is pretty nice.
The star fell below.
As much as I really did like the corpse explosion, corpse lance seems just slightly more practical. Now you do have to be actually very picky about selecting the target. Okay, as mentioned before, we are insanely squishy right now because we don't have any decent gear. Normally, the difficulty level progression in Diablo 3 is now you have normal difficulty, you got hard, then you got expert, you got master, and after that you get torment.
Save me.
Okay, argh. He did not quite make it. And the difficulty levels, they get much more difficult with each successive difficulty level. And normally, the normal difficulty, if you're completely new to the game, that's a very nice place to start. If you have played the game before, or if you're pretty familiar with the action RPG genre, then the hard difficulty is probably a better place to start. It gives you 50% more XP, monsters get a bit more life, do a bit more damage, and as such, it's just a more interesting playthrough. Otherwise, it feels very one-sided. Most of the time, by the time you got yourself all your gear slots filled out with blue and some yellow gear, then it would be time to upgrade to expert or master. I think. And then once all of your gear is yellow and you might have a legendary or two, then you upgrade to the one difficulty below torment.
No.
And it's. The bonus that Torment gives you is that starting from level 61 you get the endgame type gems to drop, and I think there was a better chance of legendary items to drop at level 70. So Torment is actually meant as an endgame difficulty, And I think you need to actually finish the game first before you can even play on Torment. But well, that said, I like a challenge.
I must have a call.
I understand so
and you definitely
much
get
more
a little
now
bit of a challenge this way. Yes, now finally the skill I have been waiting for. Command Skeletons. Passive effect raises a skeleton from the ground every 2 seconds to a maximum of 7 skeletons, which we have right now. Skeletal minions deal 50% of weapon damage as physical per attack. So, nope, 7 skeletons times 50% is 350% of your weapon damage that they automatically deal for you. So, those knuckleheads are gonna do the real damage now, and because, of course, they're knuckleheads running about, they will be distracting our opponents. Which is, of course, what I would like them to do. We got an upgrade for Grim Scythe. Enemies below 20% health have a 5% chance to be decapitated and instantly killed. So we'll run around with that one for a while. We still have our mages and our corpse lances. Well, yeah, we'll do that. Especially now that we have the skeletons with us, we should be a little safer in melee range.
That foe will die.
That said, that might be one of those silly things I say before I die. The active ability of the skeletons, that's something I forgot to read out loud. Command your skeletal minions to attack the target and increase their damage against it by 50%. The question is, of course, is it an absolute or a relative increase? So does the 50% damage that they deal, does it become 100 or does it become 75% of my weapon damage? I'm assuming this becomes 75% net effect, but I wouldn't be opposed to them dealing double damage.
No.
The nice thing is, there doesn't list a duration or anything, so it just lasts until that target is dead. And you see it's highlighted in yellow to indicate it's active. And now it is no longer. Cost 50 essence, so now that's a quarter of the essence bulb right now. Also, as I said, I'm not entirely fond of going melee with this, especially not now that we have distractions. So let's swap things around a little bit. And then just push forwards. See if we can find Deckard King. Let's see, we did find a couple of items. Well, nothing truly stands out yet. Ooh, there is a bonus to life and a regen. Nice, 500 health now. Figuring out where to go, mostly just a matter of running around until you find where you need to be. Some areas have more predictable layouts than others. I must admit I'm not playing the game actively enough and I'm not involved actively enough in the community to really know what the things are to pay attention to here. So I just apply my usual strategy of wandering around aimlessly until we find where we need to be. Which usually works.
Well.
And now we are level 10. Get our first passive ability. But first, let's have a look at the skill slots. Passive abilities. Fueled by death. Consuming a corpse increases your movement speed by 3% for 5 seconds. This effect can stack up to 10 times. Or consuming a corpse has a 20% chance to spawn a health globe. So fueled by death is pretty nice if you have the corpse explosion effect. So after a battle you just use corpse explosion to explode all the corpses that you haven't used, to get you a little bit of a movement speed boost so you can get faster to the next fight. In this case, because I have to admit, I really do like the corpse lance. Life from Death seems more useful because it gives us more health globes to keep our health up while fighting. Both definitely have their own merits, and it depends really on what kind of situations you put yourself in. Because no more tightly confined quarters like this, the corpse explosion is terribly great. So it might be that we'll actually just do some switching around. So actually setting up this fight, we could use the corpses from down there, so that's definitely useful. So one of the advantages or side effects of getting to higher levels faster means that the opponents get a bit more interesting faster as well. So right now we're just fighting white mobs, which don't have any special modifiers. And the blue mobs will have one modifier. And that's going to be it. And they're going to be drawn from a relatively small pool. The higher level we get, the more modifiers that the blue and the yellow mobs can get to make our lives a living hell, and also the larger the pool of those modifiers it gets. So there's going to be even more nasty ways that they'll try to use to murder us.
Decay and rot.
I'm afraid not.
But I have to admit, this works pretty well. You can use the corpse of the guy you just killed to try and attack the next guy and set up a bit of a chain and alley. But it is one of the nice things of just doing a full playthrough with a character and not really having a fixed build in mind, is that you just play with all the different skills, you just try everything, and you just see what it is, what it does, and how you like it. Yeah. It's one of the things they ported back over from the PlayStation is destroying enemies or items gives you a speed up.
Oh, minions, stay back! Back!
Maybe stay back!
The Skeleton King?
The power of the Fallen Star awakened me! And soon, all will suffer as I have suffered. Gods, bring me his bones!
Oh no! Deckard Cain is being attacked by skeletons. Let's send skeletons after him. After them.
Stay back.
Okay, let's just get ourselves a nice number of mages up, just to help thin out the initial herd here. Nephilim Globes, power us up as well. And then you. Let's see if you can just use all the corpses. Oh, that nearly worked. Worked well enough though, he's nearly dead.
I understand so much more now.
And that wraps up that dude. We get anything nice out of it? Not really. Oh, we did get a level. That is good. Ooh, yes. Skeletal Mage. Risen mages leave a corpse behind when they die or expire. This is nice, because it's a way for us to generate corpses without actually killing things. So that's just going to directly fuel corpse lance. And on the other side, for a primary attack, we will be shifting over to Siphon Blood. Generates 15 essence each time damage is dealt. And siphon the blood from the target enemy, dealing 300% weapon damage as physical. It also heals you for 2% of your total health every second while channeled. So this is a life drain. A ranged life drain. It affects a single target where all the other skills are AoE attacks of sorts. No ranged AoE, melee ranged AoE. This is just a ranged single target. But it heals you, and 15 essence, for every time it deals damage. So that seems pretty darn useful.
Oh, thank you, but why did you risk yourself for me?
I believe we can aid each other. Your niece told me you were here.
Oh, it is wonderful to hear that Leah is well. I fear the worst. I learned of this secret passage through old maps I found. We must discuss the fallen star. Follow me to Tristram.
We will all do that. Ka-ching.
I have found Leah's uncle, Deckard Cain. He was pursued by a creature called the Skeleton King, who blocks the path to the fallen star.
Uncle, you're alive!
Thanks to you and your friend here.
Friend? I am not often called that. But I wish to know more about the Fallen Star.
The prophecy of the End Days surely points to it as a sign that the end has begun.
Please, Uncle, not more of your stories. All that matters now is that you're back.
Ooh, and we get a phylactery. 23 vitality and 1 to 2 damage. This seems like an upgrade. So just a one-handed spear. Okay, so if we compare the stats of the phylactery with a spear we just found compared to the scythe we had, we gained damage, we gained toughness, and we did lose quite some recovery. Then again, if you have a lot of life, then you might not need to recover all of it, especially now that we are siphoning blood. So let's keep this one in our back pocket here and just salvage everything else and do a fix and have a little bit of a look. What else can we craft? So the crafting, I've got it completely unlocked. Again, this is all different from if you would play it in a inside of a season, because then you would actually have to unlock it. So got a slight edge here. But the base levels of the weapons are weirdly staggered. So currently our class items, yes, we could get rares, but the base damage is going to be pretty low. So it's better to just get something else. This shiv over here gets us quite some damage. That would be nice to craft. And indeed, it is. Without even trying really hard, we already got an upgrade. Let's craft another one, see if that's slightly better. It is not. Okay, so we'll stick with what we have. Then for armor, let's review all of our gear. A belt. Let's give it another shot, because we got slightly less vitality and... So life regen is pretty nice to have just as a passive. On the other hand, if we lose 8 vitality, that is 80 life, which at this point means we lose 10% of our total health pool. Intelligence gives us a little bit of resistance, which effectively increases our health because we take less damage. Similarly for the armor. But yeah, let's just stick with just getting our health pool up and not compromising too much on that. Let's see if we can just get upgrades from other items. Ooh, vitality bonus, a bit more armor, and we lose the speed, but yeah, I don't really care too much about that. And we get a little bit more health from health gloves, which is also nice. New kind of armor, hopefully we'll roll better and chance on it. And it's literally just a little bit more armor and a little bit more life per second, which we'll take. Got a low level rare here, a little bit of life per hit. Let's see if we can roll something better. 7 vitality means 70 extra life. So we'll do that. We did compromise quite a bit on our recovery, but I'm putting most of my hope right now on Siphon Blood. 13 vitality means more life at the expense of a little bit of damage. So that, you might notice, I am heavily biased to just increasing my life pool. But you've seen when we get hit, we take a lot of damage. So I like to push that up, just to increase our safety margin a little bit. Once we can reliably start finding... Once we've reliably find or craft rare items, then it becomes a little bit easier to just get both intelligence and vitality. But for now, I'm heavily biasing myself towards vitality. So the idea here is to see if I could get a proper shield, but we do get a little bit of damage from the heart. So for this, for this playthrough, we're just gonna settle for using a phylactery in our offhand and using a scythe if possible. But using another one-hander is fine, or we use a two-hander. But we're not gonna use a shield as our main weapon unless we get something that is no necromancer specific. Because I know there's a couple of necromancer specific uniques that have been added to the game.
Brand new goods you might be
keep this one just in case. Actually, I was gonna say just in case, but wait, why? Yeah, just in case we want the life from this one.
The Skeleton King was once our beloved lord, Leoric. He was driven mad by Diablo's evil. He lost both of his sons and his very soul before he was finally defeated. Now it seems he's risen to plague this land once again.
I will find a way to lay him to rest.
The key to defeating him lies in his old crown. Seek out our blacksmith, Heydrig. He knows of its whereabouts.
Okay. Leia,
you should not dismiss the signs so lightly. Do you not believe the evidence of your own eyes?
Horrors have visited Tristram before, and it endured.
But what of the texts? The Zakharum tomes warn of a falling star. The Herodric Scroll spoke of the dead rising, and the Lord of Lies. The prophecy of the end days says that at the end of all things, the first sign shall appear in the heavens.
Yes, you've been telling me about the text since I was 8 years old, Uncle. I just don't think we should read too much into them.
I do like the dynamic here, with Deckard Cain being kind of put into the corner as some sort of conspiracy nut. At least from the eyes of Leia, it's like, yeah, uncle. No, you've been telling about those crazy things. It's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right. Though, of course, we do have a little bit of an undead uprising and the end times seem nigh. But this is going to be a nice point to call this an end to the episode. We've been going on for a whole 48, nearly 49 minutes. So for a first episode, that was nice. We just got to set the stage a little bit, gather a couple of our new abilities, and just get a little bit of a taste of what the Necromancer has to offer. I will, of course, continue straight after this in the next episode, but that's going to be then. So for now, thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you again next time. Bye bye.